Hi, my name is Father Michael Berndt. I am with the Diocese of Springfield in Illinois. Start where I'm from. I'm from Chicago, Illinois. I was born and raised in the city, very proud of that fact. A lot of people say they're from Chicago, but they're really from like Wheaton, Mundelein. Nah, with all due respect. Anyway, so I was born and raised in the city. And I would say my life was pretty average. I don't know. I mean, I just felt like I felt like my parents loved me and grew up in a two-bedroom house in a family of seven. So we kind of had my sister was in a walk-in closet for a little bit, and she was fine. I mean, she was still a young kid. They'd since moved out. And then my dad, kind of a handyman, fixed our basement. And so we were able to expand even in the small house, that English Tudor in the south side of Chicago. So anyway, I would say in terms of faith, we just went to Mass every Sunday. You know, I remember days when I think I had the chicken pox or something, and I really didn't want to go to Mass. And I was just really like, I was kind of pumped, you know? I was like, wow, yes, I don't have to go to Mass on Sunday because I was sick. And so the reason I share that is because I wasn't, you know, some people know from a very young age of seven or under, kind of like the age of reason, you hear these stories from saints that talk about, you know, I always knew I wanted to be a priest, but that just wasn't the case for me. I always loved the Lord, though. I was never really fell away from the faith, and I praise God for that, really. Really, I do. So I remember when I was a kid, we had in our bedroom, the only other bedroom of our two-bedroom house growing up, my dad would come in and pray with us. And I think that was a really impactful just reality, that we had a dad that came and prayed with us, a dad who had the faith and who passed it on to his children. And the prayer was nothing spectacular, I promise you. I mean, it was something very free-form, and we just kind of went around the room and prayed what we thought, prayed for the intentions that we thought needed to be said out loud. And for that, I'm super grateful, to the point where I remember my family visited me in seminary, and then when they left, I really was weeping. I was really, I kind of broke down when they left, and when I was saying goodbye to Dad, because it just came into my heart that there's nothing more that I value in my life than the faith. Like, you're around a lot of people without faith just by happenstance. But I go back to those times when I was in my room and our brothers are praying together with Dad. And I'm just so thankful for the faith that was implanted, that little seed that continued to be watered throughout my life. And so going into high school, I don't really remember a whole lot from my high school faith life, if you will. Just that I wasn't really a fan of the teen masses at the local parish. I say that out of honesty. I just thought that I just really wasn't interested. But that doesn't mean I didn't go to Mass every Sunday. And then going into college, I ended up going to Quincy University in Quincy, Illinois, and I absolutely loved it. One of the first things that I did was go to Mass. Surprise, surprise. And it's easy now to say that, and then look back and you see God's providence, his handiwork in all of my life and in the journey that I'm still on. But one of the first things that I did was go to Mass, and they handed out these Mass cards. Would you like to participate, be an extraordinary minister of communion? Are you a musician? Do you want to be a greeter or a lector? Is there anything that you want to do in Mass? And I was like, heck yeah, I'll sign up for that. I never did that. I was never an altar boy. I never was a musician. I never greeted people at my church growing up. But for whatever reason, I was feeling very very zealous, especially being on my own for the first time at 18 years old and in this beautiful chapel at Quincy University, and I wanted to sign up. And that kind of got me plugged in to the campus ministry program, and the Franciscan friars are there. And for the first time in my life, I remember seeing one of the Franciscans, and they just had so much joy. Really, they just had so much joy about their life. And they didn't, you know, it was nothing explicit, but the man was playing ping pong in a habit. And I was like, wow, this is pretty cool. I'd never seen that before. I'd never seen anybody, like any religious man. I never knew any religious or priest really in my life up until that point. The only interaction I had with a priest or religious up until that point, up until college, was after Mass. He kind of shook Father's hand, said, nice homily, Father. And I remember asking some questions to Father about the Mass or about some whatever, you know. But that was the only interaction I had with priests up until college. And so meeting some of these Franciscans was really impactful for me. So much so that it got to the, I remember specifically one time I was on this pay-as-you-go phone that I bought from the campus bookstore, and I was talking to Dad. And I said, Dad, I think I'm going to be a friar. I think I'm going to be a Franciscan. 18 years old, you know, maybe 2 months into college. And he was really, you know, he just kind of didn't know what to say. He just kind of said, yeah, well, okay, great, good, very nice. Congrats, I don't know. And that was kind of the end of that. Because then I started dating. And so the religious life kind of fell off the table for a little while there. And I feel very blessed. I feel very blessed in my time at Quincy University. I always stayed close to the friars. I was always friends with them. Went on service trips, went down to New Orleans two or three times after Hurricane Katrina to kind of help out there. And always went to Mass every Sunday. I mean, maybe there was a couple of Sundays where I didn't go to Mass, but on the whole, really, I never missed Mass on Sunday. Even if I would go out on Saturday night and have fun, I always, you gotta go to Mass on Sunday. That was just planted in my heart at a very young age. So, college went on and I graduated. And that's kind of really when the vocation, the call of the priesthood was starting to get louder. I was like, okay, well, did you think about priesthood? I remember we were having people over at this really crappy house in Quincy, like 6 months. We only lived there for 6 months. After, you know, I tell people that it was really fun. I'm glad that we did it, but I'll never do it again. But there was this one night where we had friends over, and my friend asked me, you know, so what are you gonna do? Like you know, what are you gonna do with your friend? Let's call her Susan. Like, so are you and Susan gonna work out? And I said, well, I really hope it does work out, because if it doesn't, I'm just gonna be a priest. And everybody kind of laughed. And I was like, yeah, hope it works out. You know, like, still having that priestly call on my heart, and maybe something was spurring me on from the Lord there. So that was about 22 years old at the time. And I registered at a parish, my local parish, also the Franciscans, and it was right across the street from Quincy University. Felt natural enough, a very easy transition into the parish life. And I promise you, I was not really involved with the parish hardly at all. My involvement was up to the extent of taking the photos so they can be put in the parish directory and going to Mass on Sundays. But I do remember my heart being stirred by some of the homilies, especially from a dear friar who is now gone to the Lord, Father Tom Shaughnessy. And he would have these really good homilies. I don't know, you know, could I give you a verbatim one homily that he said? No. But I know that he stirred my heart to a greater love of the Lord, and for that I'm so thankful. I do remember one moment at St. Francis Solanus, the parish that I was at. He gave a homily, and then he sat down, as you do, in the little period of silence after the homily. And then we all stood up to say the creed. And I was just feeling really like I stood up, and I even literally moved my neck and looked around the church. And I was like, where are the young people? This is the truth. You know, the creed, standing up to say the creed after a really, you know, a great homily. And I'm just like, where are the young people, man? And I'm sure there were some in the pews, you know, but I was like standing there, and I went to Mass by myself. You know, I had a roommate. One was Jewish. The other one was a very devout Catholic where I wouldn't be in the seminary without him. But he went to a different parish in town just for whatever reason. And I was just like, this is the truth, man. Where is everybody? And then, like, just slowly but surely, this call got louder and louder. And then I would be remiss. I go back to my friend who I lived with. We just had these spiritual conversations. And we would talk very naturally about the Lord and about the faith life and about what stirred our hearts. And we would just have it over a cup of tea, maybe a couple glasses of beer on the porch, and just very naturally slide into conversations about the Lord Jesus. Not in an overly pious way, but in a way that we both felt, him being very Catholic and myself as well, loving the faith, we both felt that this is really the most important thing in our life, the lens through which we viewed everything else. And so because of that, we just have a great friendship, and we still talk today. I literally talked to him on the phone today, the day this video is being recorded. And I ended up being the best man at his wedding. And he came to my ordination and everything. And so spiritual conversations are just such a great part of my vocation story as well. And having that someone else that you can talk about the faith with. And so eventually I had to start taking seriously going to visit the seminary. Had a friend in the seminary at the time, and he would always ask me, hey, Mike, come and visit me. Whether you have a vocation to the seminary or not, just come and visit me because we're friends. And I kind of put it off for a while, and then I was finally acquiesced. And I said, yeah, sure, like I'll come visit you at the seminary. And that visit was instrumental in my vocation to the priesthood, because it was there that I found out I felt so comfortable in the seminary. And I felt like I was around my own people. I remember before I left, I told one of my roommates that I was living with, I feel like I'm going to seminary and I'm going to hang out with my people. I literally think I said that before I even visited Mundelein. And when I was there, a very ordinary experience, just kind of walked in and out of the buildings, went to mass. Nothing, the clouds didn't part or anything like that, but I really just felt at home. And then on the Amtrak ride back home, it was like, I don't know, 10 p.m. on a Thursday night, and I was going back to Quincy. And I just remember, again, an ordinary experience. We're not talking about the clouds parting and then an angel coming in and telling me that I have a vocation to the priesthood. Really, hardly anybody in this train. And I was kind of thumbing through this brochure about Mundelein Seminary, very basic facts about it. It wasn't like, do you have a call to the priesthood? It was basically like, Mundelein Seminary founded in 19 whatever, whatever. And this building here has just very basic facts about the campus itself. And I was kind of thumbing through this brochure and I was like, you know, I think I'm going to be a priest. I think I'm going to be a priest. And it felt really, really good. Like it felt like it was something that I was supposed to do. Since like the dawn of the age. Like I was like, yeah, of course I'm gonna be a priest. It was so clear and it was so easy. It was like I was at the beginning at the threshold, and all I had to do was walk through the door. And it was so clear to me that was what I was supposed to do. And I haven't looked back. And that's kind of my story. I joining the seminary has been an absolute adventure, and God continues to surprise me. And I love him, I love the Lord, and I love the church. And I just seek to be a servant of the Holy Catholic Church. And God has asked me to do that as a priest. Yeah, so I've been a priest now for 2 months, and I'm looking forward to what God has in store for me. I mean, I you know, just because you're ordained doesn't necessarily mean you're not done being formed. God is not done working with you. It's not just like he claps his hands and then you're done being shaped into what he desires you to be shaped into, to be a greater instrument in the hand of God for the sanctification of both yourself, but more so for the people of God. And so I'm still figuring out what it means to be a priest. You know, I mean, I have a lot to learn. In no way do I know everything, but I still feel like God has a lot in store for me. And I'm looking forward and I'm excited. You know, I just try to take you know, I'm not looking too far ahead. I put away all ambitious thoughts, and I'm just trying to be a good, holy, happy, healthy priest for the flock that God has entrusted to me. And I'm so excited. It just feels so natural. And if you're thinking about a vocation to the priesthood or religious life, I would highly encourage you. If there's one thing I would like to leave you with, one thing that just helped me along the way was I started asking God what he wanted me to do with my life. I just had this San Damiano crucifix, very apropos since I went to Franciscan college and then a Franciscan parish. I had it above my door when I was in the working world. And I remember saying prayers before I went to bed at night and just talking to God, going back to how I felt my relationship with him since at a young age, Abba, Father. And I would just speak to him. I said, God, you created me, and therefore you know me better than anybody else. How do you want me to live my life? God, help me to do your will. And slowly but surely, God revealed that to me. And I am confident that he'll do that for you if you ask. But it takes courage. And I encourage you to ask, Lord, what do you want me to do with my life?